It's time that we all woke up to certain facts, certain cosmic facts. The purpose of the universe, of course, is an attack on God. It's trying to make destruction, death real. I mean, overcome it. It wants to find a way to change reality, survive the change of reality, too. So the purpose of the universe is destructive. It is destructive. Now, of course, if there's nothing to destroy, how can you give evidence of destruction? So keep in mind that destructivity, the purpose of destructivity, the whole purpose is to prove how destructive destructivity is. If there's nothing to destroy, there's no proof. So, of course, destructivity, the flip side, the secondary necessity, the other side of the coin, is constructivity, assembling dust into forms, conglomerates, and then destroying, pulverizing it back into dust. And then it says, look at the evidence of destructivity. So, of course you're going to have all sorts of forms vulnerable to destruction. The existence is a dream, it's a fantasy, it's a hypothetical scenario. What if this could take place? What if reality could be destroyed? What if spirit could become prime creator? That would necessitate destruction of reality. What if reality could be destroyed? What if it then could be destroyed and then something new came out of it? We were able to survive that and create a new creation. That's what spirit is trying to do. But it's all hypothetical. Not real. So, this universe is destructive. Not just purpose. Destructive. So, you should realize that destructivity happens. It doesn't happen by happenstance. It happens by design. And you can know ahead of time what the design is. You can be aware when destructivity is coming towards you, coming towards a planet too. You see, destruction is not just of small little life forms. Destruction is of also planets and galaxies and, I mean, have stars, solar systems, even galaxies. So, but what we've been told is that this planet is going to be destroyed. We've been told that for thousands of years. It's going to be severe cosmic tribulation on the planet. Not just on the planet, to the planet. And we shouldn't be surprised about that at all. Then we just say, okay, business as usual. Business as usual here in the universe. The question is, though, what can we do about it? And we've been told that we can relocate. Told that thousands of years ago, too. Jesus warned us of these things. We've been warned. I mean, it's not just Jesus. I mean, this is well known. I mean, throughout the wise wisdom of the universe knows that this is what happens, and this planet is slated to be a lot of destruction, a lot of remodeling. The planet's going to be remodeled. I was actually taken forward in time, and I was shown the remodeling, the new Earth, and you could never recognize that it was this planet. No way. No way. The topography completely changed. Smooth. No mountains or valleys. Very smooth planet. Completely different. No way could you say this is planet Earth. Now, there's reason for that. Destructivity has its reasons. It's very hostile, very furious. It wants to annihilate any remembrance of planet Earth because planet Earth has failed in the purpose of the universe. The universe always fails in its purpose. To get God to judge the universe as if dreams were somehow consequential to reality. God never judges. God pays no attention to dreams at all. And so every dream that we construct, dream construction we construct, fails to be consequential to reality in the slightest bit. And this causes the dynamic to become furious and to want to obliterate failure. See, the failure is just so infuriates it, and there's this dynamic of destruction that is so infuriated by failure that it wants to obliterate, pulverize into dust all evidence of failure. So the new world that I saw, this new earth, you couldn't tell. I mean, the surface was all dust, very dusty, like granules, like sand, kind of. I mean, there'd just been a complete, total makeover of this planet. And again, it's done out of a severe hostility and viciousness. Now, we don't have to play a role in this, because we're aware. Awareness can become aware of what's going on in the universe. Because God gave a blessing to dreams, to wake up from dreams, and the Holy Spirit to inform us about this blessing. And the Holy Spirit can and will inform everyone who's willing to listen. So we can be informed ahead of time about these destructive cycles. We call it the Kali Yuga now, destructive cycle. First, the building up comes. Build up, build up, build up. We've got 7 billion people on the planet. All this infrastructure, all these animals, all this vegetation, everything. And, of course, it's failed to be consequential to reality. So the destructive phase is now coming, where that evidence will be erased as if it never were. As if it never was. We can be aware of this ahead of time, and we can sidestep it. I say abandon ship, abandon the planet. Abandon the planet. Go to the dwelling place that's been prepared for us for this contingency, for this situation. All this is foreseen way in advance. So there is this contingency plan, there is this evacuation plan. Evacuate the planet, abandon it, because it's going to be destroyed anyway. What's the use of staying here? Well, see, here we go now. If you look at human history and you have to scratch your head and you say, why in the world has humanity been so odd? Well, I'll tell you why. And I tell you why it's going to be very odd and coming up soon here as well. It has to do with trying to appease this destructive force. And humanity tries all sorts of types of appeasement to hopefully mitigate the destructive force of the universe. People think the universe was created by God, and they think God's this terrible destroyer. We need to worship and pray to this destructive God and propitiate it. But no, God has nothing to do with this universe, nothing to do with dreams, with form and energy, absolutely nothing to do with it. Doesn't even know it exists, really. Doesn't pay the slightest attention, because it's not real. It doesn't pay any attention to dreams at all. The content of dreams, utterly meaningless. So there is no angry God. It's just the destructive element of this purpose that we have. We need this purpose to try and figure out a way to survive the destruction of reality. So we try to appease this destructive force. And we try many different ways. And what? There are several ways we try to do it. We try to inflict pain and suffering and horror upon ourselves and say, look to the destructive force. Look, you don't need to do your destructive work. We'll do it for you. We'll do it for you. And we'll try to calm the destructivity down that way. If you get someone who's gone hysterical and is just out of their minds and wants to wreak havoc, you might say, whoa. You know, maybe if we wreak the havoc for it and say, look, we're doing the work. You just calm down. We'll do the work. We'll do the destruction. You calm down. Then maybe they'll calm down. They see, okay, this is being destroyed. This is being destroyed. Or someone like just blows their top. Because I want everybody, all this stuff destroyed. They say, okay, we'll do it. We'll do it for you. And then we hope that when they when they see it's getting done, they'll cool down, and then the extent of the destruction will be less. So humanity has this deep, powerful layer within its consciousness of appeasement maneuvers to try to appease this destructivity. And these appeasement maneuvers can seem pretty bizarre and pretty astonishing. And it requires really complete change of human psychology and the way we look at human psychology, because the people who talk about human psychology, they don't understand it. They really don't understand it. It's rooted in the fear of cosmic destruction, our psychology, how we function, consciousness, how it functions. So the way to appease, try to deflect and appease this destructive element that's coming to destroy this planet, is to try and carry out the destruction ahead of time and on a superficial level, hoping that will appease this ferocious, angry God. I mean, the whole story of Jesus being crucified, appeasing the extreme, utter wrath of God, because people knew that the planet had been devastated by water before. And that's in the collective consciousness of the devastations, really. There have been quite a few. And they see God as this occasion, sometimes benign, like nature sometimes benign. Other times it becomes utterly wrathful. So all sorts of cosmic destructive events that can take place on this planet. So they said, my gosh, we got to find some way to appease this destructive God. And so we thought, what does this destructive God hate the most? And it hates reality the most, of course. So I said, well, if we can offer up a sacrifice that symbolizes reality, that is a chunk of reality, as it were, and let this destructive force kill that, wow, that'll like really appease it, like maybe forever. That's what they hope. Of course, this is totally insane. But again, appeasement is not dealing with sanity. It's trying to figure out an effective way to appease this destructivity. It doesn't understand how to sidestep it. So it keeps thinking, well, we just got to calm it down somehow. Well, there's no chance of that. No chance of that whatsoever. And I know that directly because I met face-to-face, as it were, vibration to vibration, consciousness to consciousness, the destructive force that's coming on this planet. And I pushed and prodded and stood up, say, hey, you know, what are you here for? You're gonna carry out what you're here for? Have you changed your mind? You know, have you weakened your will? Anything possible to see? And no, not the slightest weakening of will. This destructivity will not be deterred from its mission at all. So I know that. It's rather frightening thing. Absolute fury. Just total concentrated will to devastation. Now, seeing that, I said, well, we just have to get out of harm's way is what we need to do. I mean, the smart thing is just abandon ship. You're not going to change this destructivity's purpose at all. It's not possible. And yet we keep thinking we can, which is a huge mistake. And that's the worst mistake, terrible mistake. I think that somehow we can find a way. So we go into all these appeasement measures, and what this culture, modern culture, has done is it set up all these appeasement measures, set them up, got them ready. It's got them ready. Which is why if you really look beneath the surface of modern life, you start to see this is something is really weird actually, with modern life. Really weird. So what is going on? I mean, why? Why is it the way that it is? Well, because these appeasement measures have been set up. So the plan is for humanity to devastate itself. Devastate the planet ecologically, climate-wise. It's already done that. But these are all things deep down. It's intentional. It's intentional design. It's to try and devastate at a superficial level. Humanity devastate itself, devastate the planet, and yet leave enough still there so it can bounce back. You see, it's trying to mitigate the full fury of the remodeling that's coming. So it's all intentional, all by design, and there's many ways that are utilized. It's not just war, it's also traumatizing oneself. We don't realize that people, humanity, the consciousness we call humanity, traumatizes itself. It traumatizes itself in an attempt to mitigate, appease and mitigate. All attack is self-attack, actually. All of it. All of it. And it's a dance of collaboration at a deep level. At a deep level that we're not willing to admit. You see, we're not willing to look at this deep level because it brings up the whole issue of cosmic destruction. And we're simply unwilling to look at it. I'm one of the few who has been willing to look at it. So I'm reporting back what I have seen, what I can see. And it's not difficult anymore for me to do this if I set my mind to it. It's not something that I enjoy doing, really. But there are times when you have to do stuff you don't particularly enjoy. So being willing to help humanity out, I've been willing to look at it in depth for a lifetime of effort to look at it and see this is what's going on beneath the surface. When you look at like an ocean and it's the sun's out and the glare is hitting the water and you see the sparkling on top of the water, you cannot see anything beneath the surface. You can't see at all. All you see is reflection. So you don't know what's beneath the surface. In order to know what's beneath the surface, you have to put on a mask and stick your head underneath the water and take a look. It's the only way. And it's like that. As far as the consciousness goes, you have to be willing to look beneath the surface. And what you see beneath the surface is quite different than what you see superficially. Quite different. And so that's tough. It's tough to do because you say, wow, nobody's going to believe what I have to tell them because they're looking at the surface reflection and they just don't even think about what's beneath the surface. If you look beneath the surface, you say, oh my gosh, look at all the stuff down here. There's an entire dimension and realm and so full of crazy, weird stuff down there. Wow. And so you poke your head back up above the surface and say, hey, everybody, you know, this is what's down here. They say, oh, you're crazy. You're just making that up. That's nonsense. And so it's not easy to do this. Not easy, to say the least. Because what you see there is, uh-oh. The universe is a nasty place, very nasty place. And we are really, it's fear-based. All dreaming is fear-based. All imagining, all fantasy, the hypothetical that we picked up is fear-based. The hypothetical to set down hypotheticals is not fear-based. It is not. That is love-based. So all fantasies except the happy fantasy of setting all fantasies down, the blessing of oneness, the blessing of non-judgment that was given by God upon all dreams, that is not fear-based. But all other dreams are fear-based. So fear drives us to do very weird stuff. And indeed, in efforts to appease this monstrous destructive force of the cosmos that attacks planets, tries to wipe out all trace of the previous inhabitants, as we've seen on other planets, starting to realize that, wow, I said, the surface of this planet used to be very different, but something happened. Wow, what happened to turn it into this wasteland, you know? Like, you look at Mars, and they're studying Mars, what's going on? Well, that's why. That's the destructive capacity of the cosmos. It is vicious. So, we don't want to look at that, but we need to. And the appeasement of that, trying to appease it, we inflict trauma upon ourselves, hoping that the hysterically vicious cosmic destructive force will look at that and say, oh, they're doing what I want to do. Maybe they can do the job for me. I don't have to do it. And that's the idea. So the trauma we inflict upon ourselves to try to appease this cosmic destructive force is incredibly vicious. Incredibly traumatic. you talk about the most heinous kind of crimes and vicious drama, etc. We do it all to ourselves. We do it all to ourselves in a desperate effort to appease this destructive force. And I'm not, with no exception, we traumatize ourselves. And we refuse to admit it. Also, we say, oh no, that person attacked me, or you know, that wicked, terrible person attacked me. I have nothing to do with it. It's not true. But superficially, we have this agreement that we will, nobody, you know, we will not look beneath the surface, because then that will traumatize. Everyone will get like hysterical thinking about cosmic destruction and say, oh my gosh, it's true that, you know, what are we going to do? A freak out, like a total freak out. So we prefer to play this charade that nobody collaborates in their own trauma. That's a charade. We absolutely do. And it's all, again, sort of desperate appeasement measures. And what we feel is heroic, actually. We feel that we're doing something very, very important. So human sacrifice, for instance, used to be very, very popular around the world. All done to appease the cosmic forces. This is very well known. They had terror about cosmic forces, like comets and eclipses and all this kind of stuff. And when they were aware, like an eclipse or comet was, or eclipse was coming at least, and to forestall any future ones, they would practice human sacrifice, and the collective society went along with it. A lot of the victims were captured in battle, but. This was very widespread in ancient times, very widespread. Sacrifice of all types. Now, this shifted in some places to sacrifice of animals, saying, look, we'll take our most precious possession, our most prized animal, and we'll murder it, we'll kill it, all to show you how willing we are to carry out destruction at any point. We'll destroy whatever is most valuable, whatever you want. Just don't come here. You don't need to. We'll do the work for you. It's an attempt to forestall cosmic destruction. All of that, the whole sacrificial thing. And there are other deeper layers to the dream that we've talked about before. But this one here is an area that people don't want to look at. So it's necessary. It's a key. It's a key thing. Very key. It's the area that we're most unwilling to look at. And we just say, boy, I had like an anxiety attack yesterday, and it's terrible. And I said, wow, boy, if this keeps going, this is going to wear me out, and this is bad. I said, well, there's something I'm not willing to look at. There's something, I don't know what it is. And I went to sleep, and I woke up at 4 in the morning, and I realized, boy, I'm not going to be able to get back to sleep. And the anxiety is coming back, and uh-oh. And I said, you know what? I just got to make an effort to see where is this anxiety coming from, really, because this is bad. And I thought I looked at everything. I said, how could I be anxious? I've looked at everything. What should I be afraid of? Well, I looked and I looked and I looked, and then I saw this whole cosmic destruction appeasement dynamic that I hadn't seen with really perfect clarity yet. I sort of have poked around, but I hadn't quite seen the bare bones of it. And now that I have, it's like, whoa, you know, hey, uh-oh. People aren't going to like that, I tell you, because this whole victimhood thing, like, you know, is so popular. And it's tough for people that they're unwilling to recognize that they victimize themselves. It's something they attract to themselves. Why? Again, to appease this cosmic destruction, to appease worse destruction. And in the past, it was just open book. You know, anything that something bad happened in nature, what would people do? They'd round up sacrificial victims and sacrifice them, or animals, whatever. So it's always, we've always used death and destruction to try and appease cosmic forces, whether it, you know, nature here on this planet or other cosmic forces of the sun, etc. So they were just direct about it. You know, they weren't trying to hide it. Now we're indirect. You know, in the biblical times, if something bad happened, they'd say, well, it must be because the people are sinning here in the world. Someone sinned, so we need to round up the sinners and kill them. Or we need to make some great sacrifice to show how willing we are to punish the evildoers and punish ourselves and punish everything for not acting appropriate, right? Because we think that the cosmic destruction is brought upon us because we're not following some rules and regulations properly. That has nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with it. But we invent this stuff just to give us a sense of control. All of these rules and regulations, etc., just give us a sense of control, a feeling like, hey, we have a way to prevent this destructivity from raining down on our heads. But that really has nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with it. It's the very purpose of existence is destructivity, the very purpose of it. And so you cannot change the purpose of an idea, the effects of an idea, you cannot. So it remains destructive no matter what we do, no matter what we do. This hypothetical, what if we could be prime creator, gives rise to a dream whose purpose is destructivity, and that always will remain destructivity. And no matter how many rules and regulations and prayers, etc., we incorporate in our lives and rituals and etc., it doesn't make any difference. So not ultimately. We can manipulate stuff. We try to find little stuff, but as far as changing the purpose, no way. No way. So we spend all this time trying to follow more and more rules, thinking like if we just follow like a trillion rules, everything, and do it all right, do all these rituals, cosmic destruction will not occur. We'll keep it at bay and neutralize it, deactivate it. That's not how it works at all. What you have to do is choose a new hypothetical. Well, hypothetical that comes from what if I didn't want to be prime creator? What if I gave up the idea of being prime creator? What if I gave that idea up? That's a hypothetical. That hypothetical doesn't have any destructivity in it. Okay, so you really have to exchange hypotheticals. You have to exchange belief systems, hypotheticals, exchange fantasies, exchange dreams. That is the way to do it. That is the way to do it. Not maintaining the same dream and finding some secret rituals that will deactivate the destructivity of that dream. That is not the way. That is not the way. So all of this is highly relevant to the times because destructivity is on its way. It is on its way. And it won't be long before this planet is going to get nailed. And before that happens, what will happen is what's called the Tribulation Period. And the Tribulation Period, in a lot of ways, is at appeasement. And look at this. It'd be a gigantic help, gigantic help. But not everybody wants to look at this at all. They're too frightened. We're locked into this appeasement mode. And I'm just one of those who was never really locked into it. Came into this world with awareness of the cycles of cosmic destruction and was not locked into appeasement mode. So I've been able to frantically spend a lifetime trying to get people to wake up to this and see what's going on and realize we don't have to try to appease this. It's futile. So why traumatize ourselves? Why slaughter ourselves? Okay? Why go through all the horrors that occur in mayhem and warfare, etc., that we're all very aware of, men, women, and children, in all different ways, including all the sickness, the starvation, the homelessness, the displacement, the infrastructure destruction, all of that stuff, along with disease of every kind, and just, you know, fires and ruination, all the horrors of destructivity. Why even do that? Because why? It's futile. It is entirely futile. It won't appease the destructivity in the slightest bit. So it's all complete waste of time, utter waste of time. So I know that, and I'm just sharing that with everyone so that they can say, hey, why should we do that? That's stupid. If it doesn't do any good, why even do it? It's nonsense. But we're sort of locked into the zombie-like pattern of just thinking that that's, what else can we do, you know? Well, we can sidestep it. We can relocate. That's the great gospel Jesus gave us, relocate. He said during this next tribulation period, it will be the worst. This is the worst ever. And it will really virtually, basically saying you need to sidestep it. You won't survive it. You won't survive it. So he said, I'll come back at that time and I prepared a place for you. I'll come back at that time and take you to the place I prepared for you. Very simple. No mumbo jumbo esoteric stuff. It's very simple. Because relocation is the way to handle something like this. At the very least, relocation is the way to handle it. At the very least. Okay. So that is what is the sane thing to do. Appeasement doesn't work. So relocate, and you can work on exchanging hypotheticals at the same time, which is ultimately how to free yourself from dreaming altogether, which is necessary for us. So we will keep working on this and keep bringing this to light. It is the sane thing to do. It is the right thing to do. It is true activism. Activism about truth. All right. Very great. That is it.